we'll start with the announcements, with updates, what's going on in the world of customs and how it relates to upcoming exam. And then we'll switch to main topic, which we'll hopefully get to, and that involves the anti-dumping. So, going to announcements. We are going to, well, Customs just posted this particular notice about flowers, and it deals with the topic of marking. Of course, I had you guys go over the topic of marking a couple of weeks ago, and as a prelude to the free trade agreements and country of origin and all that other good stuff. So this time Customs is trying to make a point that they say, okay, so marking is well, the importation of flowers is on the rise, and flowers which are involved, which we're talking about here, they're part of the J list. And of course, J list is one of the topics which are being heavily tested on the exam. So one of the J list line items, for example, is the cut flowers. J list is codified under the 134.33, and you have a laundry list of items which do not need to be marked. And cut flowers, which is a topic of let me see, I think I missed that. Yeah, right there. So cut flowers, which is a topic of the discussion, were part of the J list. So a lot of flowers have been imported. That's understandable. They do not need to be marked, but however, they do need to, the outermost container needs to be marked. Well, the nature, according to that article by Customs, the notice by Customs, the way the cut flower business works is the outermost container in which the product is being imported, and you can see the picture there. This is not necessarily the outermost container in which it reaches the ultimate consumer. And you can probably confirm that by just going to your local grocery store and buying flowers over there. If you are having a some kind of cut flower bouquet, you check it out and see if it does say or doesn't say the country of origin of where it comes from. So Customs makes a big point over here, is that, listen guys, they say since the new container in which it will reach the ultimate consumer, and of course the point here is on the ultimate consumer, you need to make sure that you are being you are marking that ultimate container in which it reaches the ultimate consumer. At the very least, you have to make this kind of certification which do state that that you need to mark the stuff as it reaches the ultimate consumer. So this is one of the examples where you have the kind of like a outer or long arm reach of the CBP rules and regulations, which reach beyond the border, beyond the frontier, and target all the way up to the supply chain logistics and all the way to the ultimate purchaser. This is rooted in the marking statute. The statute is 1304, and it does have the goal of the ultimate consumer in mind. So the way the Congress puts it, is the ultimate purchaser. So it kind of does make sense. The certification themselves, they are listed in part 134.25, and that particular part does state that particular language, certificate of marking. While we have, as historically speaking, JList is a very popular topic to be tested on the exam, but while we have seen a lot of things that are related to the JList, we haven't seen that certification stuff on the exam, at least not to my memory. Having said that, however, what if you do not follow through the certification, do not follow through the marking requirement? What happens then? Well, the statute itself, the congressional one, is quite harsh because it says, listen, if you do not comply, the penalties include imprisonment. So this is a criminal statute, right? Not more than 1 year. So that's if it's imprisonment for not more than 1 year, it's probably not a felony. It's more like class B misdemeanor, I think, because A misdemeanors, I think it's a misdemeanor, not a felony, in other words. But it's still criminal stuff. It will go on your record. It is something not very pleasant, to say the least. However, having said that, you need to keep in mind what is being tested penalty-wise, and what is in a real-life occurrence is the additional duties. And the additional duties hits your pocket. So if you don't mark the stuff correctly, in addition to all the other penalties, in addition to all the other stuff that you can be assessed on, that 10% additional duty can be collected. There have been several, several court cases related to that, where you had the importer bringing in products which are not properly marked, the Good Samaritan, Good Samaritan in quotation marks, they brought a lawsuit under the False Claims Act. False Claims Act is the type of statute that says, okay, so if the government can't catch you getting away with non-payment of taxes, fees, whatever revenue collection is involved, if you are being proactive, you can get a cut. So what will happen in those cases is that they saw that importation were not being marked, so they came in and filed a lawsuit on they call them a realtors, right? In a litigation, and they pretty much says, listen, they've been skimming U.S. government of 10% of those duties because they didn't mark them correctly. So let's make them pay for this, and we want our share. So given the size of the companies, that was pretty significant. The last case I read was goes back maybe 5 or 6 years. It involved a Midwest plumbing company. I forgot the name, but it's significant stuff. So that's on the marking front. So I think that particular announcement was a good way to start the review of the items. In addition to the marking announcements, I think I did say that we do have some updates as far as outlines are concerned, outlines for the chapters dealing with free trade. What I've done over the course of the week is I went in and I looked at since the last time the book was updated, I looked at the type of questions that were being asked on the customs license broker exam related to free trade agreements. I excluded some of the stuff that are being not likely to be tested. Specifically, I'm talking about North American Free Trade Agreement, aka NAFTA. And I sent out the outlines. I'm gonna briefly go over of the new stuff that came over, and from then on we can move forward to the other stuff. So GSP, Generalized System of Preferences. Keep in mind the customs. I got a notice that they just updated this page with new information. Please keep in mind that GSP program has expired, and it does so every once in a while. And what usually happens when the GSP lapses, you still have the procedural elements in place which allow you to still file all the other stuff or the GSP claims. And once Congress passes the law reauthorizing the GSP, it usually kicks in, and it means that less paperwork for the filers, for the brokers, for the whoever does entry, for the importers. Unlike NAFTA, which deals with the law, which is a law which essentially became outdated and substituted by United States-Mexico-Canada Free Trade Agreement, GSP is around. So please don't be fooled by this notion that it is expired and therefore it's not likely to be tested. Most likely it will be tested, and because questions from GSP, they creep up, not too much, not too little, but they do creep up, and this is something to be mindful of. Of course, I did provide the link on several occasions. I'm gonna drop it down in the chat window. It's also the link is also part of the merchandise processing fee textbook, and what it does, it provides you with what MPF is exempt and it is which one is not exempt. This is something which is very useful as you analyze your free trade agreement. So if you don't have it handy, please make sure you do have it handy, because this can save you a lot of time. One of the examples that would be the time saver would be the question. Let me see. It would be the question 38 from October 2018 customs license broker exam, and it pretty much says, okay, so examiners they want to know what merchandise processing fee is not collected from this free trade agreement. So you have a list of five, and if you use that chart that I just mentioned, you quickly know that which MPF, merchandise processing fees, are exempt and which are not exempt. And you can quickly establish, for example, we have what's known as qualified industrial zone, for example. This is refers to part of Palestinian territories, which are under Israeli control. It involves Egypt. It involves Jordan. So while Israel, for example, is exempt under the Israeli Free Trade Agreement, something which is made in, let's say, Gaza Strip, would not be. So going back to the question, question that was asked. So you have Jordan Free Trade Agreement. You go back to that list, and you see it is not exempt, right? Meaning that the fee, the MPF fee, will be collected. Miss Abby, I sent that those by emails before this stuff. So what I'll be doing is, because there is so much to cover, I will be sending the links through the chat window. However, if you make a note and send me the separate email, I'll be happy to send them out, because this is just simply too much information. It just goes in and out, and if I'll start sending emails out, people just might get confused. That's where we're at. Okay, so you have Morocco and Egypt. So we talked about Egypt. Egypt is a is part of that trade agreement which that qualified industrial zone, if it is in Egypt, which is not exempt from MPF collection. We what was the other one? I think we had Morocco. So Morocco is there. It's also not exempt. And of course, here customs examiners, they are being kind of tricky. They say China free trade agreement. Of course, there is no free trade agreement with China. And what you have here is you have kind of like a miscommunication, because the fact pattern says one of these free trade agreements. So China really shouldn't be there, because there is no such free trade agreement, unless they're talking about just China being part of the WTO and getting that MFN status. So Australia is the one which is correct, and it is there. You have Australia. It is exempt from merchandise processing fee collection. Of course, there is a citation. So right there, just by quickly looking at that particular chart, you can quickly establish what type of answer customs examiners are looking for. And in this case, it will be answer choice B, Australia FTA is not being collected. All right, so part of the outlines which I did send out were also had general notes on FTAs. So let me see if I can take. So this one we're done with. Okay, so so this is the outline that I sent out a couple of days ago, which talks about just overview of. So of course, later chapters they do drill down into the specific free trade agreements, but here we have the we have just a general coverage of the stuff, just kind of like the tip of the iceberg type of thing. So the things that were updated as a part of the review, they include additional free trade agreements. So we have, let me see, we have Nepal. So in other words, in the original textbook, you will not have Nepal. You will not have, let me see, Japan. Japan is also recent. And you will not have the, let me see, the USMCA, United States, Mexico, Canada. So those stuff, they have been added as a part of the update. And this is something which I encourage everyone to use instead of using the chapter version of the provision. Of course, that is also provided in the general note 3 of the harmonized tariff schedule, so keep that in mind. I did have a discussion with some of you about the 520D claims and how they are creeping up. So that the 520D has been addressed as a part of general free trade agreements because they're kind of tied. Even though it deals with post-entry, the 520D is tied to is tied to the free trade agreement with particular countries. The list of countries has expanded. Before, also I had a question on how to look up the free the most current version of the United States code. And the reason we need to do that is, although we're not we're being trained for code of federal regulations, and the United States code is not part of the equation, you still need to be able to understand what it is. You still need to know the hierarchy, and you need to know the you need to go to the source sometimes. In this case, I did provide the link. So the link is at the lower bottom right corner of the website, locustoms.com. It's right here. So if you click on that one, you'll be able to jump to the title and the section. Now, of course, title is 19 and the section is 1520. And once you click on that, you have that pop-up, which will provide you with the most recent version of the agreement. And the 1520D does provide the laundry list of countries which have been expanded since the book was written. A quick note on 1520D. It's part of, let's say you are the importer, and let's say you are qualified for the free trade agreement because you are able to source product eligible under this laundry list of countries, which I just put up on the screen. So in this situation, and at the time of entry, you did not do that. What are you doing to kind of correct the situation? Well, in this particular case, this 1520D thing has not been codified. In other words, it hasn't made its way to the Code of Federal Regulations, but nevertheless, it's such a big part of the customs licensed customs broker import export practice that customs examiners simply cannot avoid it. So the way they do that is, as you all know, we do have ACE business rules that are part of the equation, and ACE business rules, they are required material which comes well, the link is provided, right? So you guys should all have it. And on page 21, they do have a list of countries which are part of that 1520D 1520D eligibility. So that simply means the formal procedure with which you will be doing the claim. If you forgot that to do, if you forgot to do that at the time of entry, is not the protest claim, but it is actually the 1520D claim. So it's just another route. I will so no, a little no, well, notice if you look at Columbia, if you guys can help me out, because I thought that Columbia is spelled with O, so COLOMBIA. And if you go to the congressional text, apparently the let me see, we have the Columbia right there. Oops. Columbia spelled with an O. So if someone can tell me whether or not both way to spell it is the correct way or not, because I'm trying to include this stuff in the textbook, and I simply spell it with an O, with a double O, without U, but apparently both ways are correct. Or that can be a typo. So that's something interesting. So going back to the business rules. So the business rules, they have been appearing quite frequently with as a part of the exam. And I do not have before at the time the book was published, it was mostly Kater, which did not involve ACE to the large degree. It involved the ACS, automated commercial system. So since then the technology has developed. So now we are dealing with ACE, which is pretty much another language, another set of codes which achieve the same thing, to try to make stuff efficiently, to digitize the processes and do all that other good stuff as a part of technological progress. So as I usually cover it toward the middle, but I skipped the assignment for this particular chapters in the business rules. I plan to dedicate either the last class or the class before last to the ACE business rules, so that way we have it under our belt. So I'm not dropping a ball with the ACE business rule with you, but because business rules are covering a lot of business practices. So we're talking about entry, we're talking about free trade agreements, we're talking about the post-importation stuff, we're talking about declaration of quantities. So since they cover all the stuff that we are taking as a part of focused, dedicated analysis chapter by chapter, I think this particular business rule discussion deserves to be toward like the very last class, or the class before last one. So that way we can kind of tie it up into one thing. So this is to come. That's on business rules. Okay, so that's the general notes on as far as the as far as that chapter is concerned. I also sent an update on the Dominican Republic, Central America United States Free Trade Agreement. There was one question that CBP examiners did ask within the context of DR CAFTA, and that relates to the symbol, to the special product indicator, which you need to declare as a part of let me see, as a part of the claim. To claim the Dominican Republic's Central America Free Trade Agreement, you claim that with a symbol P, or you claim that with a symbol P plus. And in here, when you make that claim, Let me go to the right update just to show you what I'm talking about. Whenever you make that claim, they did decide to finally ask you a question about the special program indicator SPI P+. So in other words, when do you make a claim for P+? And that was kind of tricky question, simply because the way the Congress had enacted this whole P+ thing is written in a clumsy kind of way, which is kind of hard to understand, even even if you are a lawyer, you still scratch your head and sometimes think, what does it say? And of course, we're talking about that P+ situation within the context of SPI. So what the way the CBP examiners have approached it is they decided to say, okay, so this is what we're going to do. We are going to ask you a question in this particular form. Let me pull it up. All right, so they CBP examiners said, okay, so so what is the significance of P+ when you are dealing with, for example, agricultural products? And the significance is very simple. So you have a list of countries which are part of the agreement, and the list of countries is at the beginning of the outline, and there is origination criteria which are going quite detail, but basically here is a list of countries, and of course United States is on the list, number 7, right? So you have United States being part of the agreement. So since United States, and of course this is a country which is a big player, right? So in this situation, it would make sense for stuff that are coming out of the United States by way of inputs, let's say seeds, all right? They should qualify as counting toward the origination. However, what that particular section, or that P+ section says, if that particular country is United States and there is a P+ symbol, then you cannot use United States as a part of the equation, which is kind of weird. It kind of doesn't make sense, but nevertheless, it is still something which has been going on. So you need to make sure that you make a note of that, because for some reason CBP examiners decided to test on it. And the way they test it is this. So going to our outline, page 6. They said, look, so what's the significance? And to translate all that bulky language in a conceivable form, all it says is that if you see P+ sign, you cannot consider materials toward your origination analysis. In other words, this particular P+, and it relates only to narrow type of products. It relates to what's called the agricultural products. So in this case, We are dealing with that P plus. So that's the only addition that I had for this particular dear kaftan. Otherwise, everything remained the same. All right. So that's on Dominican Republic, Central America Free Trade Agreement. All right. The next on the list is Korea. So let's take a look at the Korean Free Trade Agreement, which can be translated to many other free trade agreements as well, because it deals with the question of transshipment. So the only thing that was added is that transit or transshipment clause as a part of the inquiry. So what does it say? Well, it says the following, that let's say you have the stuff from Korea, and this stuff transshipped through a different country and entered the commerce of that country. Let's say they were used, or they were for sale. They entered the warehouse and then they were subsequently resold. It doesn't matter. They entered the commerce. In other words, they were outside of control of customs authorities of that country. If that happens, the country of origin will still remain Korea, but the eligibility for the Free Trade Agreement preferential program will go away. So that's one of the things that in a recent exam, CBP exam has decided to test on. And the way they test it is by giving you a hypothetical on a Korean Free Trade Agreement, saying, all right, so we have automotive radial tires classified in HTSUS. They are made in Korea, they originate, so they qualify as a country of origin Korea. They qualify for the Korean Free Trade Agreements, but something happens along the way, and this something is that they go to Japan. So Japan is a different country, and they entered the commerce of Japan. And because they entered the commerce of Japan, they are now, by that clause, they are automatically disqualified from the Korea Free Trade Agreement. So the answer to the question, are these tires eligible for the chorus Korea United States Preferential Free Trade Agreement? The answer is no, and the reason for this answer is because they entered in the commerce of third country. In this case, they entered the commerce of Japan. As simple as that. So that has been the update that that took place with respect to Korea. Make a note. That whenever you have a question, so let's say you are they're asking you a question which you have no idea how to answer. If you're dealing with free trade agreements, it's very important to understand that there are basically two sources of information which sometimes overlap. In this case, the rule for transshipment with respect to the Korea Free Trade Agreement is found in both places. It's found in the HTSUS, and it is found in the Code of Federal Regulations. So keep in mind that as far as HTSUS, Harmonized Tariff Schedule of the United States is concerned, let me see, let me go to that general notes. So we're dealing with, let me go page 828. Yeah, right there, transit and transshipment. So this is the the text that you are looking for within HTSUS as a part of Korea country version. Note 33. But also, in addition to that, you have Code of Federal Regulations, and under the 1025, the section 1025, transit and transshipment, if you click on it, you'll see the same thing. It cannot go, it's pretty much word for word. It cannot remain under control, it cannot go to process of operations. The only thing it does, it adds a procedural caveat to this, unlike unlike the version within HTSUS. But nevertheless, you have two sources of information which overlap. In this case, yes, we do have the Code of Federation qualifying, and notice it's located in part 10. And let me go back. The part 10, generally speaking, you need to make a mark. Remember, I'm trying to make you guys become a librarian. This is the particular part which deals with all those free trade agreements that are out there. Not exclude part 12 also somehow touches on the freebies, but part 10 is by and far it's ex extremely it's a go-to chapter as far as free trade agreements are concerned. So that's something to keep in mind as far as Korea FTA. All right, so and the next on the list, of course, I have had questions from you guys about the pharmaceutical chapter. Yes, recently, with the, especially now with the role the pharmaceutical products play in our lives in light of pandemic, we do have the questions in this type in this time increasing number of questions related to the pharmaceutical products chapter, which is also updated. So let's see. Okay, so we're done with Korea. Let's pull up that pharmaceutical stuff. So as far as pharmaceutical, not too much to know. As far as, I mean, this is complicated stuff. I'm dropping down the link in case, but you guys also have it by mail, in the form of attachment. So the addition that this they said was dealt with the question of pharmaceutical index. So to qualify for, I'm sorry, pharmaceutical appendix. So pharmaceutical appendix is found in at the end of the harmonized tariff schedule. So if you imagine that this is a printed out version, you go all the way to the back and you have various indexes, right? And appendices. So the what in this case we're talking about this particular text, and if you do open it up, you'll find that right here you'll find a bunch of scientific stuff. So it has various tables, three tables altogether. One table deals with CAS numbers, which is a chemical abstract service. It's an organization that maintains the numerical list, and then you have the what they call it, generic names of various well, pharmaceutical products which are used in pharmaceutical industry and eligible for preferential duty. And notice that the list is quite exhaustive, but they also have a different table Let me see if I can pull that one up. So if I just jump to the page 80, right, you have another table, and the table has the chemical definition in addition to the CAS number. So that's the product name, also known as IUPAC name. I'm just dropping it down so you guys are familiar. There is basically there is several ways to present the name of the chemical compound. The product name, the way it is presented to the on the left hand side, is something which is more exact than a CAS number, although you can pull up that information by putting a CAS number in the directory. So and then of course there is a third table which does something in between. The idea yeah, so see the in between meaning that they do away with the CAS numbers. All right, so but basic idea here is that it has to be listed in that particular table to get qualified. And the update that was done here is to simply reinstate something which was already part of the chapter. It must be in a pharmaceutical appendix. So if you look at the question asked, the chemical rutacyte will be imported. That's a new question. Into the recent question, I mean. To the U.S. from Germany, and it is packed in such a way it has this HTSUS number. It has that special product indicator K. What other reference must do to get the duty-free treatment? And the answer, of course, well, you must have pharmaceutical appendix. In other words, it takes several things. So number one, you have to have the HTS number, which provides for the preferential duty, in this case, marked as K. It has to be listed in the pharmaceutical appendix. And if you do with that, you're pretty much good to go. You can get that preferential treatment, irrespective of which country it came from. So notice this stuff is not based on, is not focused on the treatment of countries, so it's a free trade agreement in a way, but it's not based on a country, it's based on a product. We have also other trade agreements which do something similar, so that would be the aircraft agreement. So if you guys ever do work with freight forwarders, for example, especially the ones that close to the ports, or airlines, you know that, for example, the airlines, they need to move around parts all the time in order to keep airplanes moving, to keep the business flowing. And so you have aircraft parts, which are being kept here and there, and there needs to be some kind of provision which allows quick fixes without too much tariff burden. And in this case, they did it under the aircraft. So before I move on to the other topic, let me just go back to that HTS and make a point of what is important. So this is important, and ISO codes, which is represents the countries. So whenever you have, for example, Germany, it's DE, right? Whenever you have Korea, South Korea, it's KR. And you have port codes. So those, so you have Annex B, Annex C, and the pharmaceutical appendix. So those are the important items to mark out as maybe with a tab as you prepare for customs license broker exam, because most likely you will be going to the back of the HTSUS.